Hello, boys and girls. You read the title, let's get straight to an animation demo. Here I'm calling the Python script sphericalpendulum.py. This is what we're going to code up today, or I'm going to describe the mechanics and the code for it. And this is this animation of this spherical pendulum. What we have here is some fixed point, right, on the top, let's say. And then there is a rigid string on which there hangs a mass, and also a sort of virtual bowl. And this is just the simulation, the mechanics simulation, the true Lagrangian mechanics simulation of how an actual, idealized pendulum would behave. Sure, there is no modeling of any friction or air or something effects. Everything is very perfect, but nonetheless, the Newtonian mechanics are correct, and it makes this nice nice pattern. And I can also move around this animation. This is done, as we will see, with matplotlib. It ends up drawing this nice pattern. I have set the frame rate down to 10 frames per second, so that might not look as pretty as it looks if you have only this thing running on a powerful machine, but this is basically what you get out of it. And I started this with some starting positions, right? I started here at this point, and it already had some velocity around this sort of bowl, and I can also change that. So for example, let's close that. And let's go to the file. I'm going to explain the file in much more detail later. But here we can change this initial conditions. And I've written down some of the parameters that kind of make sense. Let's go with here 5 and 2. So that means that I start not as high inside the bowl, and I start with a faster velocity around the phi angle. And what will that look like? Something like that. All right, so I start somewhat more steep and not as high in this bowl, right? And it makes a motion. It will again make this nice flowery pattern. So let's just enjoy a little bit these animations. And just for explanation, this bowl, right, this kind of red orange bowl, this is just for show. This is just for clarifying where the boundary condition is, where this pendulum on a string can even be, how it is restricted. And this is then also the boundary condition that is implicit in the model and how the Lagrange mechanics works. Let's try some other configuration before we get into the code. Of course, I could also change the starting initial condition of the phi position, but it would not change much. It would just be a rotation around this already symmetric bowl. And I could also change the starting velocity that's in the theta direction. We're going to describe this coordinate system in a second, but these are not so interesting from a graphical visual perspective. So let's take another sort of let's set this here to infinity, basically, this to infinity, meaning that the velocity in the phi direction is zero here. And let's go, this is the same standard pendulum we see, right? This the standard pendulum is of course a special case of this spherical pendulum. We just take away 1 degree of freedom here. here the starting condition is exactly as high as the ball is high, and that's also just a visualization, of course, right? And then I have one last setting. I think that I have not tried yet. I think this, let's go with this, 4, 6. So here I have 6 in the denominator for the velocity in the phi direction, so it doesn't move as far, and so it makes a much more, like, even more flower-like pattern. Give it 10 more seconds just to get some pretty picture. Okay, and in this video we are going to deal with the code for this thing. There is a lot of videos I've done in the last 1.5 months, which sort of lead up to it. I discussed the kinetic energy computation in spherical coordinates. I have used the SU2 group for that, which is, of course, in a way overcomplicating it. Nevertheless, the result is the same, and you could also redo it in just, you know, standard spherical coordinates, Cartesian coordinates, sort of way without computing determinants. And I have also made a separate video on the Runge-Kutta integration scheme. So what is underneath this simulation, one of the things, is just a normal, ordinary differential equation integrator with the scheme that is discussed in this previous video. And so I will show it, I will quickly browse through it, but in this video I will not discuss much where the kinetic energy or the Lagrangian comes from, and also not really how the integration works, because this is really explained in the other video, and you can also, of course, check out various resources on these sort of topics. Okay, that's for the animation. Maybe I come back to it at the end again, but no, let's now discuss how this works. So, as I said, we have the Runge-Kutta solver. This is in a separate file here. I will later browse through these two functions for a second. I have here a file with some utilities. I will also step through them, although they are, like, really super simple, just some tools. And then this file consists of starting conditions. Then the sort of more mechanical physical part that I have heavily documented here, and that implements this ordinary differential equation, even though it's also, like, despite having 2 degrees of freedom and a lot of trigonometric functions, it's sort of basic, it's sort of easy to understand, I suppose. And all of the messy numerical work is here in this integrate function that is part of this other file. Then there's one coordinate transformation to move back from the configuration space with these angles in which we are compute this situation to the physical space, so that we have this three-dimensional simulation, even if it's just restricted to 2 degrees of freedom. And okay, then there's some plotting function. I will probably skim over it because it's basically just basic matplotlib and not so interesting. And finally, then there's this animation tool that I have also used, right? So at the beginning of the year, or in March or something, I did a virus spread sort of animation, I think. Or no, I explained this this animation tool that can be used to do that. I didn't go far in the virus direction, but so I've also explained this other elsewhere. I will step through it quickly, but I will not dwell on it too much. And then this animation tool is ran together with this plotting function and the popping of the stream of the integrator, and that's basically it. Okay, so before we get into these codes, let's explain a little bit of the math, although in this video I will not go very deep with any of the physics. Firstly, please subscribe to the channel. I'm currently doing this reading streams with some papers. If you have suggestions for papers, if they're more or less approachable also for other people, hopefully a little bit more on the basic side. I'm very open for these sort of suggestions. So as I said, I have done a lot already, like explanation of tools that I use in this video. The Runge-Kutta integration scheme is described in that video, and building up to that, I did two videos on these infinite streams in Python that I use to pop out more and more solution points of the ordinary differential equation solution on a time grid, right? So you have ordinary differential equation, let's say in a parameter time, and you have an initial condition, and then one after the other, you pop out the next point that is numerically computed. And for this, I use this Python stream thing, which is kind of very nice, neat, and short. But if you want to understand that, if it's a little bit too much from just looking at the code in this video, check out these previous videos. I had my fun with this particular Lie group and Lie-algebra, where I talked about SO2 and rotations, as I did in previous videos as well, where I used that to derive the square of the time derivative of a coordinate in three-dimensional space. And I was using the SO2, adjoint representation to rotate it around, and ended up computing the kinetic energy in spherical coordinates. So this is some term with some trigonometric function that I will take for granted in this video. It's also all stated in the Spherical Pendulum Wikipedia article. Discussed, especially in the first video, in the SO2 actions for spherical coordinates, I'm going to make use of the here's the picture, the spherical coordinates system, where we have this phi angle here. So when I talked about the velocity of phi around the z axis with the animation before, I was talking about having an initial condition of motion along this phi. Then here's a theta angle going down from the z-axis, and in the animation, as you saw, the sort of ball is on the bottom, and we are going to use this sort of inverted coordinate system where we're actually not going to have the upward pointing z-axis, but the downward pointing z-axis. But this is made very explicit in the code, so it should not lead to confusion. And as far as the integration goes in these two-dimensional systems, this algorithm does not care about whether or not you put the z-axis like that or like that, because in the Lagrangian system, in these generalized coordinates, in these angles, you don't see really the embedding of this ball, whether or not it's at the top or at the bottom. And then there's, of course, the radial component, which will be not of interest to us because our situation has the boundary condition that the distance from this center point from the top that is hanging is always constant, so there's nothing going on with that. This simplifies the kinetic energy also a little bit. So this is not a physics video, but let me mention sort of the principle behind it. We have this situation where we have just the classical mechanics set up with a constant force pointing to the bottom, right? This is just a gravitational force. We say this is the mass of the object times some constant gravitational acceleration. This is the standard approximation. You have the gravitational acceleration of 9.81 meters per second squared, pointing downwards. We are not going to use Newton, force equals mass times acceleration, on the nose, but we have the situation where we oppose also this boundary, right? We say that the object hangs on the string, and the way we implement it is actually not talking about this rigid string so much, but we are going to consider this sort of ball, the restriction that we impose, the analytical mechanics restriction that we're interested in is this virtual ball, and we demand that all motion only happens in this inside of this ball, on the surface of this ball, and all configurations are given by the angles, the two angles, maybe some derivatives of the angles. And the tool that is used for that, right, the theory which lets you incorporate these boundary conditions into Newtonian mechanics, right? This is basically Newtonian mechanics plus some mathematical commitment how to throw away the Newtonian dynamics of the boundary conditions, right? We treat the ball as like unresponsive, like whatever, how hard you would hammer with a hammer on the ball, it would not be stretched, it would not be moved. And the mass on the string has no effect either on the string nor on the ball at all. So this is like this hard boundary, and the mathematics that you use to describe that in a standard way, it's very technical sort of theory, is the D'Alembert principle, which looks like that. So you have here the force minus the m times acceleration in the scalar product with this virtual displacements equals zero. In this case, of course, the mass, we are going to say that the mass doesn't change with time, right? So usually you have the, a changing mass, like mass changing with time. If you have some, I don't know, a rocket which like throws away exhaust gas while it flies, and so gets lighter while on the flight. So that then you would have this term, but in our case, of course, the mass is constant. And you know, I actually don't really want to talk about the virtual displacements here in that video. In any case, this is some fairly involved differential geometric concept that in this fashion generalizes the Newtonian mechanics in a way that lets you make a commitment on how to model certain infinitely pushing back forces like the ball or whatnot. Okay, so in any case, this is the underlying principle that one generally uses, but of course from this one immediately derives, at least for time independent boundary conditions where the force is integrable, you can derive from this thing the Lagrangian equation. So this is the equation that is actually then used as the second order differential equation. Let me just browse down. The equation that we want is this here. So we have some Lagrangian, which is going to be the kinetic energy minus the potential energy. Kinetic energy we've already derived in the previous video. Potential energy is also very simple because it's just a constant force of gravity. And then we have two parameters. We have these two angles. And so this means two differential equations, ordinary because it's just here time derivatives involved of the angle. And so that's the background. That's the physical background, right? And so now let's step to this spherical pendulum Wikipedia article. Here you see this general setup being given a picture. As you see here, as I said before, this has this downward set, right? So as opposed, here's the angle is like the zero angle has the lowest point here. Like theta equals zero means you're very at the bottom, while if you go back to the spherical coordinate thing here, if the theta was at zero, the point was on the top relative to the origin of the coordinate system. So just want to highlight that there is one minus flip going on for drawing the thing. Here is some comments on the Lagrangian mechanics setup, and they end up then here with this Lagrangian. This is the kinetic energy term. Again, I will not explain why it looks like it does, because we explained it in very painful detail in these previous videos. But suffice to say, it's just a velocity squared, right, in these coordinates. I mean, you can also follow here this Cartesian computation, then you just have this, have to get rid of this cosines and whatnot, and you end up with this thing. And then there is, the potential energy for this force. Right, the force is this pointing downwards gravitational force. It's the mass times the constant g. And if you want to go to the potential, well, then, you know, as you know, work is force times integrated path. And so this is this energy quantity. So it is m times g times some integrated path, in like the way that how far away from the floor you are. And if you look at this picture for a second, then it's clear that if you consider the lowest point with theta equals zero to be the zero point, okay, then the height of the pendulum is the length L times this cosine, right? Okay, so if you accept that, and if you accept that the potential energy is force times height from the lowest position, and you know energy is always relative, you can add a constant and it doesn't change much in the equations of motion because you take the derivatives on both sides of the Euler-Lagrangian equation. So then that's the Lagrangian, and the equations of motion are given by these two equations. So this is the first one with the theta, this is the second one with the phi, and this is a Lagrangian, and thereby the system is determined, right? So you can then plug that in and compute it, and then you get two second order differential equations, which look like so. The first one is here the second derivative of phi. So, you know, this is just this. This is just what pops out. And this is dependent, like the second derivative is dependent on basically all the other things. Like it's dependent on the theta angle, and it's dependent on the velocity of phi. So this is like a genuine higher dimensional higher component ordinary differential equation, where the second derivative depends on both zeroth and second on first derivatives here. So it's a little bit messy. And the other one looks like so. So this is also, this is even worse. Here's the second derivative of phi depending on both first derivatives and theta. Neither of them depend on the zeroth derivative of phi, i.e. neither depend on just phi directly on the nose. And therefore you get, you know, some, in the classical theory of the differential equations, you get some benefits there. You could go into generalized momenta and help yourself a little bit by finding out constants of motion and so on and so forth. But we actually won't make much use of that. We are okay with what we get from this sort of equations because we have our solver, and we just need to rewrite the second order ordinary differential equation as a first order differential equation in the usual standard sense. You will see that explicitly in the code, and we were going to just use that and with our whatever fine-grained integration steps we have, and this will work out fine. Okay, so these two equations are exactly what you saw previously here. This is literally this. This is the second d2, meaning the second derivative is exactly this thing. And here's some encoding of the data to jump from one point to the next. Okay, so that's the physical background. Now let me do the boring part. Let me step, just for the sake of completion, through the utils and quickly through the integration scheme. And I would be super happy if somebody would engage, you know, and you say, I like doing stuff in this and that programming language, and you just rewrite that. Might be interesting. If you code up this thing and make a nice animation in some other language, then I will go on and take that and talk about it in a future video. Okay, so this is Python. I use NumPy because I need it for like cosine, sine, and trigonometric functions and all these kind of things. Otherwise, I pretty much hands-on implement all the things. Here's the inner product of two vectors. You know, not going to explain it. This is just literally the inner product. Vectors, then here, weighted mean, where you, you know, compute the average, but with weights that might not all be the same. Here is a short implementation function to transpose points. I will just use that for the plotting because the input for the plot functions in matplotlib want to transpose data as compared to how I use them. So nothing interesting happened here. And this is the function which takes you from coordinate space with theta and phi to the unit sphere in R3. Well, there should also be no surprise. You have surely seen this before. And that's that. Then this is the solver. I have explained this in detail in this previous video. I imported utils simply because I used the weighted mean. This is part of the Runge-Kutta 4 scheme. Here is this stream that where you start with initial conditions, it computes the next point and then ends up returning it. And you compute the next DT increment with the this Runge-Kutta scheme, and then you loop on forever. You have this infinite stream where at every point you add the next increment and then return the Y, or the other way around. Okay, and this is the scheme. I'm not going to comment on it much, but it's there's of course this theory on whatever, like ordinary differential equation integration schemes make sense, and this is the simplest one of it of them that kind of gives stable integration scheme. Okay, and the rest of this file is just this example that I've shown in the previous video, which integrates some, you know, Gaussian function or something. Okay, so here I need the plotting library. I need NumPy again. I think just for trigonometric functions. I import the Runge-Kutta solver. Here is the at the start of the file, so that it can be used in the rest of the file. These initial conditions. You have already seen how this works. Like I just need to change them, and then the whole solver starts differently. So we deal with two dimensions, right? We have this phi and theta coordinates in configuration space, and we deal with a higher order, deal with a second order differential equations. And what we will do in a second is we go from the second order differential equation to the first order, like formally first order differential equation. And for that, we need to, as a trade-off, to double the vector that is integrated. And so we go to 4, and so that's why also you can say initial condition is four values, right? Two coordinates and second order. And here's just a trick to have this sort of abstract computation. I could also write just 2, but if you have some other sort of mechanical problem where you maybe have 7 degrees of freedom, then you can reuse the code. You just need to have the various entries. Okay, maybe you have to compute it smarter because you cannot divide by 2, but let's say you have 8 degrees of freedom. Then in that sense, then this is just a way to get the right degrees of freedom out of this vector for a second order differential equation. So this is just keeping it very, very generic, right? We could also do just 2. Then there's these parameters like the pendulum length and DT, they might influence the integration accuracy and so on, because in here the second order, you can see that if L is huge, for example, right, then this becomes approximately a much more simplified equation because every G and so on falls out. And you know, it makes sense because if you have this huge huge pendulum, then right, okay, I'm not going to go into the dimensional analysis here, but what I'm going to get at is these parameters, they affect how this is integrated up, and the same holds true as always for the dt, the integration step, right? So if I don't know, if I go here with 300, yeah, right, then what I think will happen is that it looks like it moves slower because he computes more points at the same angle distance, right? Yeah, so this looks now like it's frozen because it's like moving incredibly slow, because let's say if this is 1 centimeter, then now he does like computes like 10 times the points. And in the other direction, if I go down with it, then he will jump much wilder. And this might also lead to numerical problems. Now I have set it to 3, right? And now it goes crazy and breaks. This is because you get a higher inaccuracy in the solver and things break down. So I coded this up a month ago, so played around, and these were some nice values. This is the same situation with these things, right? Also, you know, if you don't watch out, and the simulation also depends, like how are your trigonometric function implemented, right? Because naturally these are some transcendental functions, some real numbers, and this is always subject to an approximation as compared to the analytical theory. Okay. Recite a little bit this sort of trick, how to go from a second order differential equation to the first order one. Well, okay, here I link the Wikipedia articles that I pointed to. The integration is in principle of this form, right? The second order derivative equals some force, and I have motivated that we end up just using these Lagrangian equations where the boundary conditions, the bowl is already like part of the modeling system. We have these two coordinates q and differential equation, like these two differential equations for theta and phi, are of this form, right? Some g, some function of the two lower derivatives. So g equals, on the one hand, this expression for the first component, and secondly, this expression when we divide the sign out, right? So the second derivative of phi minus 2 first derivative of theta first derivative of phi divided by the tangent, because you know tangent is sine over cosine. So this is g, this is what determines g, and now we do some consideration. Hey, what is actually the Lagrangian? I've already motivated it that the force is m times g, the height is given like that. And so here's this one minus, this of course depends again on this, however you put the coordinate system, but it's clear that what we want is that if the theta angle is zero, meaning if this angle is zero, then we are at the low point. And since we can set the potential energy reference value to whatever we want, we say at the bottom we have zero kinetic energy, and then the maximum kinetic energy is the higher you go, right? So if you go up to pi, then you have whatever max, and the fact that we model the force as this constant gravitational force mg means it's mg times this height. So I state that you know, this is just how you compute the work or the potential energy. This is the amount of force, the absolute value of the force times how far you went, which depends on theta. And here I give some examples. This I just motivated that for theta zero we are at the bottom, and then for pi 1/2, this is when it's like this is like, do I have a bowl here? Wouldn't have been bad to get my muesli bowl. But if this is the bowl, and so here is the bottom zero, and if you go here, then you are a height of L, because the length of the pendulum is L, right? And so the potential energy is mg times L, and this is exactly what you see here. And just to be sure, the Lagrangian is, of course, the kinetic energy minus the potential energy, right? Okay, so this is how we get to this L, but again, I'm mixing things up now. I already discussed the mechanics, and I just want to explain the logic of this integration approach. So what we do here is we take this G, right? Remember, the G is in terms of the configuration space coordinates, meaning the angles. And what we do is we take the second order differential equation and rewrite it to the first order one by defining this variable, I call it here y, to match with what we had in the Runge-Kutta notation, where we say the first component is just q, and the second component now are the velocities of the angles, basically the first derivative of the angles. This is now twice as big because q is two-dimensional, theta and phi. And we can now take this equation now says that q second derivative equals g of y, right? Y has exactly these two data points as information. And so the second order derivative is the first order derivative in y, with f being exactly this thing. So it says that the derivative of q is the derivative of q, right? And the derivative of q is the second component here. So the first two rows of this differential equation is just the identity. And the actual thing that we want to solve is in the lower two components, right? And I hope that makes sense. You can think it through yourself if you take pen and paper and do it on, write it down. But this equation is the same as the second order equation. I mean, this equation is the same as the second order equation with one trivial identity added in the top rows. And so this is how you would do this reduction of orders. And so we have this equation to solve, which our numerical integrator can solve. And we have the G that we need to implement that. And that's exactly what is done here. So, okay, we need this gravitational acceleration. This is just this G. Then there is a G over L. This pops up here, right? I call this omega squared, and I think this is standard. You know, it is of units 1/2 squared, right? 1/time squared, because acceleration is length over time squared, and this is length. So this thing has the same units as a rate squared, right? 1/time squared. And so it makes sense to call it omega squared, omega standing usually for frequency. And so this is just a concept I'm going to use. And well, we have defined y as q and q prime, meaning theta phi, theta prime, phi prime. And so once we get the y in this g, I just unpack it, I give it just different names. Then what we need is a bunch of trigonometric function. I compute them here and give them short names, c, s, t. And then I have the two differential equations, which are exactly what we saw before, right? This g then returns these two values, right? Our g is this, it returns the second derivative. This is what we computed here. And our f is, as we said, the first derivative and g, right? So f is the first derivative and g, the second component of y is this, right? I could also write it like that, where y depends on, I could write it like that, although it might be a little bit confusing. So second means project out the second part, project out this thing. So that's exactly what we do here. F has first two components, dq, and these dq are part of f of y already, and this is what we compute here. So we have now our f, and this is exactly what we need for the Runge-Kutta solver. So here the Runge-Kutta solver solved exactly this sort of situation for any like size vector y with initial conditions. And that's what we plug in here. And because it's this nice stream, it does already work for us. It's very like concise. And so this thing, if we give it a starting condition, which we do here, sorry. Yeah, which we do here, then it produces all the values, infinitely values, if we wait long enough in our stream. Okay, so the rest is also very simple. What I do here is I take this stream of y's, and for plotting it, I need to translate it to physical space, meaning to three-dimensional space. What I do here is I take the y which is popped out. I'm only interested in the q itself, not its velocities. So I project out this q. I put it to the angle computation, like angle to sphere, right? This is the what we had in the utility function. This is this thing. And I do this flip that I talked about. And yeah, that's pretty much it. Then this is just format convention cast. And so this thing is now our like converted stream, right? This y stream out infinitely many solution points. This now stream out infinitely many plottable solution points in three-dimensional space. Okay, I'm not really going to discuss this plotting tool, right? It's just standard matlib plot. I define the overall dimensions of what is going to be plotted, this box. I plot this sort of bowl. I produce a lot of grid points and then plot these surfaces. These are like this matlib plot standard functions. And then I plot the pendulum thing, right? I have this point at the top and then this line and then another point, and the point is what moves. And what this thing takes as input is all the points, right? So if I run it, then no, it streams and collects more and more points, and at every point, like at every frame, I pass it everything he has computed so far, all the points. And it plots all of them as these green dots. And then for the last dot, he makes this fat blue point, this pearl at the tip of this sequence of points. And that's how that comes together. Okay, I leave it running in the background a little bit and go for the last part, and then we come back and see how much he has drawn. So that's that. Finally, there is this sort of plot stream tool. So this makes use of the matlibplot animation thing, right? I import at the top here matlibplot, and I use just this package, which also makes it very attractive because I basically use nothing to do this whole thing. And what happens here is this is a class where I say frames per second and blah, blah, blah. And then I set up on the one hand this stream. This is like what pops out more and more solution points and a collection of points. There's nothing creative here. This is just the running this animation function with whatever input it needs, right? It needs the figure to add stuff and the next frame that is computed here, and the next frame does exactly what you think it does. It takes the stream, which has the solver, right? The solver points, it pops out with next, this pops another point. The next point is added to this pass points list, and then the plotting function is called with this pass points. Here's some, like if you try that on another system, I'm here on a MacBook. If you try it on Windows, then you might have play around a little bit with this sort of, or Linux, you might have to play around with the settings. I showed the files to some friends who tried to run it on their systems. I think these configurations should run on all the systems. If not, then here are some hints or some things you can change and you know, it's a little bit of a messy library. I'm not a big fan of matplotlib, but it comes directly with Python usually, so it's okay. And then I run it, and that's what you get. So let's go back to the plot. Sadly, it's a little bit slow. I would like to see a full fleshed out version. But I also set the settings very low, simply so I can actually do the recording and all these things at the same time, because the Mac is not the strongest one. Let me see if I do, what will it do if I go for some crazier number? I've not tried this out before. Okay. And I killed it. Wait a minute. Let's actually go to 500 here. Just for experimentation's sake. Oof. I cannot even turn it around anymore. Okay, this is probably pretty much the same. You can play around with this a little bit. Again, I would be very interested if people aren't want to code this thing up themselves. Then whatever language you use, I will install it and try to redo that and see how it looks in other languages. I've done this before, so that would be very cool. And tell me if you want to learn more about, I don't know, classical Lagrangian mechanics, which I think is one of the most beautiful subjects. Here I have here this German book that I mentioned in my books of 2021 series video. If I find the time, I would like to talk more about Lagrangian mechanics. So you know, especially since I think I have a lot of viewers who are just mathematicians and computer scientists, and they might not be so familiar with all these sort of principles and how things come together. And I to be honest, I think there's no good video on this sort of subjects, because people like to simplify these physical principles and get over with and just deal with the differential equation that is postulated in the end or derived from the postulates. But the understanding, in my opinion, is often small, even among professors, because they don't really bother. They go into their special field too soon and don't stick with these things. And I like to come back to these things every other year, and I always get something new out of these sort of principles, right? I mean, this shit is 400 years old, and a lot of thoughts got into that. And so I want to do more of this kind of sort of stuff if I find the time. If you're interested in it, let me know. That's it. Thanks for watching. Give me a like, leave a comment, and I am looking forward to this year. It's going to be a good one. Take care.